If you're expecting Pat, then apologies, but I'm doing it instead. And we've got probably a couple of hours or so on this, and a couple of exercises as well. So we should be done for sort of 9:30-ish, something like that. So what I want to do is put this in perspective, because whilst I'm standing up in front of you and giving the information that you need to pass your exam, it isn't just about that. What I want to do is to give you information that will be exceptionally useful in your cross-country fly-in. And the reason it's useful is because when you start out on XE flying, your brain is just full of loads and loads of stuff going on. So what you want to do is to concentrate on the things that are really important. You need to concentrate on flying, staying up, working where the next thermal is, centering your turn, all that sort of stuff. What you don't want to be worrying about is whether you're allowed to fly into that circle, whether you're allowed to cross that town, how high you should be here. All that stuff should be just absolutely drilled into you so you know. So when you come to this place, what do you do? Are you allowed to go ahead? Do you have to go around it? What should you do? I'm not going to ask you to answer that now, but when you're first setting out, they're the sort of questions you'll ask yourself. What do I do now? And what you want to be doing is concentrating on where the lift's going to be, not whether you can cross the town or not. Are we safe here? Little airstrip there? The answer is you don't know until you start comparing your position with an air map, for example. So that is actually right on the edge of what was a restricted area around Sheffield Airport. It's not there anymore, but it was there. And most importantly, what do you do when you get here? And what you do when you get there is celebrate, because you've just flown to Skeggy. That's Skegness Station. And what we're going to do later is an exercise on flying to Skeggy. So, the reason to ask you to bring air maps, hopefully a few have brought them we can share, is to map out your flight to Skegness. We're going to map out the fact we're sat on Bradwell, it's a westerly, it looks like a really good day. And whether you've flown 5k before, whether you've flown 50k before, one day you will exceed what you've ever done before by quite a margin. And what you want to put you on the ground is maybe a poor decision about where the thermal was or something like that. What you don't want to put you on the ground is whether you can cross Scampton or not, or whether you have to go round Lincoln. They're the things that you should know. So that's what I want to tell you today. And all that is wrapped up in this BHPA air law exam. So these are the scary maps. Whether you've got a paper map, I had someone muttering earlier, don't like using a paper map, just too big and too bulky, that's fine. Whether you've got moving maps on a Kobo or a UDI or whatever wonderful flash 23-inch screen laptop or whatever it is you've got on your flight deck, you will need some sort of map with lines and circles on it to tell you where you can and can't go. I need to know what those lines and circles mean. Personally, I fly with a movie map, but generally, for the big picture, I also fly with that. That is always out, and I always refer to it. So here's the plan for the evening. Some of it is pretty dry. I have to tell you some pretty dry stuff tonight. Apologies for that. But in amongst there, hopefully, is some useful stuff that you better use in your day-to-day flying. So I need to talk to you about documents. I need to talk to you about altimeter settings, what they all mean. I need to talk to you about airspace, zones, airways, what they all mean, where we can go, where we can't go. Reading air maps, exceptionally useful bit, that bit. I need to talk to you about all these abbreviations. I'm not going to try and explain them now, I'll explain them later. Rules of the air, which I hope every single one of you knows backwards, because they're all in your CP. You're asked them again in your P exam. So, hopefully you all know those because a lot of you have been flying with me. Compasses and radios, I need to talk to you briefly about that. I'm going to go through some abbreviations, and if there's any more questions at the end, we can answer those. So, the catchily titled documents and promulgation, which is basically what's around and how do we find out about it. There are a lot of documents. some of which you need to know about and some of which you don't need to know about quite so much. So, aviation law in England, it is a law enacted by Parliament. It's called the Air Navigation Order. And actually, if you go in and read this document, a surprising amount of it finds its way through in plain language to what we do every day. So specific rules about where we can and can't fly, specific rules about what we do when we're flying and we can't see particularly well, lots of specific rules, and they're all there, all absolutely clearly mapped out. The Civil Aviation Authority is the body that's responsible for civil aviation, and they basically use this this system called the AIS, Aeronautical Information Service, to collect information and then disseminate it to pilots such as us. And it does that in three ways. You can go to AIS, you can see stack loads of stuff in there, some of which, again, you need, some of which you don't. The three key ways in which it gets this to us, this is the first one, it's called the AIP, Aeronautical Information Publication, or UK Air Pilot. And this is like long-term stuff. So if there's going to be a new airfield, for example, if there's going to be another runway at Heathrow, those sort of things, they're the things that will go out in AIPs. It's a big document, three volumes. There's a summary document called, well, actually titled a booklet. It's a big document, the booklet, which is a digest, and you can get that from the BHPA if you have trouble sleeping. The second way in which people get information to us, is through NOTAMs. See the handy little post-it note on here? There's a few little post-it notes scattered throughout this document, this presentation, so they're the ones in which you should pay particular attention to because they're the ones which are most useful. So NOTAMs are called Notifications to Airmen, NOTAM. And what they are short-term pieces of information. So I mentioned in the slide before last that the AIS collects information and then disseminates it again. So we could, for example, post a NOTAM which says we're going to fly on, someone mentioned an aircraft flew through Cat's Tor today. So we could post a NOTAM saying we're going to fly on Cat's Tor today. That if we do that in good time, that then goes out to all other pilots who choose to read that. And they might then say, you know what, I'm going to avoid Cat's Tor today because there's probably going to be some paragliders there. So NOTAMs are exceptionally useful bits of information. Any sort of short-term hazards, changes in airfields, for example, air shows, particularly important for cross-country. So Battle of Britain Memorial flights, Red Arrows, those sorts of things. They are all announced by NOTAMs. And every time you go cross-country, part of your morning routine should be checking the NOTAMs. And there's a couple of good websites. NOTAM Info is one. Which maps it out in a really good visual way. So you can plot your track, you can see. It's a circle there over Lincoln. What's going on there? Battle of Britain flight, 2 o'clock till 2:40. I need to note that and have that on my flight deck because I don't want to go through the Battle of Britain flight. The third way they get information to us is through aeronautical information circulars. These are published monthly, and they might give sort of operational changes, administrative changes, changes to airspace charts, for example. So the BHPA has just negotiated with the CAA to take off four pieces of restricted airspace. You might have seen it in Skywings, which relate to Atomic Energy Authority installations, one of which is Harwell, which hasn't been an energy installation for a little while. So those will go out as an AIC. And we'll then know that we can fly through them officially and legally. That's it on that section. Any questions or queries? Very short little section. Okay, I want to talk about altimeter settings. Because curiously, knowing how high we are is quite a difficult thing to measure. It's also an exceptionally important thing to measure because airspace always has different heights. This is actually what somebody said several years ago over the radio in a DSC environment. First of all, units. So we mix our units when we're flying, which is very useful, but let's concentrate on the key ones. Let's make sure we all know what they are. So FT is feet, M is meters, NM, nautical miles, KM, kilometers, MB is millibars, which is a pressure setting, a pressure unit, and HPA, which you see occasionally used, is an equivalent to a millibar, 1 hectopascal. We're typically going to work in millibars, so you might see HPA elsewhere. So here's us flying somewhere near the sea. There's a windsock where we've taken off from. So how high are we? That's the question. And there's three ways of measuring how high we are, and they're all important for different reasons. The first thing to consider is actually what we're doing is measuring pressure change. So a lot of us fly with GPS now, we get our height from GPS. Actually, we should be getting our height from pressure change, because that's what's consistent in terms of what people use across the world. And the air pressure changes by about a millibar every 30 foot of height you gain, which is convenient. It also changes, of course, with weather systems. You'll learn about a stack about that last week, which is particularly inconvenient. So what they do is split the UK into different altimeter setting regions, depending on where the pressure is at the time. So we can actually measure our height a little bit more easily using pressure settings. An important number is 1013.2 millibars. That's the average air pressure at sea level. And that's a baseline, which is used commonly. And another definition, AMSL, above mean sea level. You'll see that come up in the next few slides. So how do we measure our height? The first one is using QNH. I'm not going to go on what the abbreviations mean, but QNH is your altitude above mean sea level. And the mnemonic for remembering it, it's not what it means, but the mnemonic for remembering it, if I can say that, is query nautical height. So nautical height, sea level. And what QNH is, QNH is, it's actually a pressure setting they give you. So this is a little bit old school as to how it's done. But QNH is a pressure which is given by air traffic control. It's the pressure at sea level at that time. The pilot, whatever he's flying, a Lancaster or something, clearly, because it's quite old school, dials that pressure reading into his altimeter, and that altimeter then turns out the height at which he's flying. QNH, that's actually what QNH. QNH is more commonly just given as an altitude, but it is actually a pressure setting. So, but QNH gives you your height above sea level. The next one is QFE. And again, the mnemonic for this is query field elevation. It's your height above the airfield. The reason this is important is because your airfield might be miles away from the sea. You might have flown in from the sea, you've got your height over the sea, it's really foggy, but actually the pressure is significantly different. The pressure is a big weather system or something like that, so the general air pressure has changed and you might end up flying into the hillside or something like that. So what you do, you radio through to the airfield at which you're going to land. The airfield then gives you the QFE pressure setting. You dial that into your altimeter and it tells you your height above the airfield, so you know exactly where you are height-wise in relation to that airfield. So that's the second one, QFE. We might commonly use height above takeoff, for example, if we're going to land back there, but QFE is the official terminology. So the pilot needs the pressure setting for the airfield. You ring up air traffic control. ATC say QNH is 1015 millibars. That's the pressure at sea level. QFE is 1000 millibars, which is then the pressure at the airfield. So if we set our altimeter to the pressure at the airfield, we get the height above the airfield and we can land safely. So QFE is a pressure setting by ATC and the current pressure reading at the airfield. The third one we need to know It doesn't affect us quite so much as it used to, but we still need to know it, is something called flight level, or FL. When we go and look at the air maps, we'll see that a lot of the heights are described in just numbers, so 4,000 feet, 5,000 feet, 6,000 feet. Others are described as FL85, which is a flight level. And what a flight level is we assume, the flight level is the height above a pressure level of 101.3.2 millibars. So that, if you remember, was the average pressure at mean sea level. And the reason we need to do this is because if somebody takes off in Australia and flies, sets their height above sea level, and then flies through a dozen weather systems and pressure systems and ends up somewhere else in the world, their height above sea level is significantly different because the pressure at sea level has changed. So above a certain height, when people get completely clear of all the ground, which I think is 8,000 foot plus, something like that, or most of the ground, then all aircraft switch to flying at flight level. So wherever they've taken off from, whether they've taken off from Australia in a low pressure or taken off from the UK in a high pressure, we don't get high pressures here, but let's assume we have, then as they fly together, they'll start off like that. As they fly together at the same FL, then they know that they can miss each other. Sorry, if they're different FLs, they know they can miss each other. So it's the height above an imaginary a line, a pressure level, 101.3.2.
So when do you set that?
QFL? Flight level, you might need to what most pilots do is fly with height above sea level displayed and the flight level displayed. And again, when we look at our air maps, when we get particularly high in some areas, then we need to know where we are in relation to flight level because some of the bottom levels of the airspace are at flight level. The thing with a flight level airspace, if airspace is 5,000 feet, it's always 5,000 feet above sea level, so we can do that quite easily. If airspace is at flight level 85, depending on the pressure, that might drop down to, a flight level 85 is 8,500 feet if the pressure is 113.2 at sea level. If the pressure is higher, then that flight level will go up. If the pressure is lower, that flight level may well drop down. So it might well be as low as 7,500 feet, or might be as high as 9,500 feet. So if you're going to fly in an area where, when you've looked at your map and looked at the track you're going to follow, there's some airspace there which is at flight levels, then you would want to have a flight level on display. The reason it doesn't apply to us quite so much anymore is because they changed the minimum, or they changed the threshold at which it's displayed either, explain this very well. So, for example, right over here used to be FL45. We need to know the pressure, we need to know how exactly high we can go, whether we can go to 4,500 feet or 5,500 feet, for example. They changed that a few years ago, so instead of being FL45, it's now 4,500 feet. Places that are above, I think, 8,000 feet are still done as flight levels. And it's rare we get to that high. I think I've only been that high once in this country. So, but where you see something on the air map that says FL, then you need to know what your flight level is. So FL65 is flight level 65, which on a mean day, where the pressure at sea level is 101.3.2 millibars, it's 6,500 feet. But if the pressure is different to that, then that flight level 65 could be as high as 7,500 feet, or it could be as low as 5,500 feet. We see flight levels when we're high enough to figure out about the ground. It's more important we keep away from each other than we do could keep away from the ground. So everyone uses the same pressure setting on their altimeters. So everyone going in the same direction flies at exactly the same flight level. People are going in opposite directions, flies at slightly different flight levels, and then they'll never crash. So the UK, the transition altitude can be as low as 3,000 feet. I think there's only a few cases where that is where that's true. It's generally 6,000 feet, and I think it's still 6,000 feet locally then. I'd forgotten this, but it was proposed to go up to 18,000 feet, in which case we would really not need to worry about it at all. So if I look at this then. All right, we'll look at the air maps later. There's a couple of flight levels on there that I can highlight to you, which is 7,500 feet plus. So on an amazing day, which has probably been one of the last 20 years, you might get that high. Right, so these are the altimeter settings. So we've got QNH, which is the altitude above mean sea level. We've got QFE, which is the height above the airfield. And we've got the flight level, which is the height above a pressure level of 1013.2. So if our sea level on a mean day has a pressure 1013.2, then our QNH will be exactly the same as our flight level. But it's rare for that to happen, so QNH is really different to flight level. That isn't the simplest stuff to explain. Is there any queries on that? Okay, I'm going to move on then before things leap out. So I want to talk a bit about zones and airways. Some of this stuff is a bit like a jigsaw. It's not clear what to talk about first, and you need to know some of the stuff that comes later to make sense of the stuff that comes earlier. And whichever way around you do it, then that's the case. So we have to sort of work our way through the whole lecture for some of the earlier stuff to become a bit clearer. And that is the case here with zones and airways. But this is more about where you can and can't go. Our airspace is divided up. Hopefully you know that by now. You can't just fly anywhere you want. We have four active classes of controlled airspace in the UK. There are five classes in total. I don't believe there's any Class E anymore in the UK. And in controlled airspace, basically we are controlled by air traffic control. And in general, you need to be in communication with air traffic control to be able to go in there. It is unusual for paraglider pilots to fly in controlled airspace, but not unheard of. I'll rephrase that. It's unusual for paraglider pilots to fly legally in controlled airspace, but not unheard of. And then we've got classes F and G, which are uncontrolled or otherwise known as open airspace. And this is generally where we fly. It's also where a lot of other people fly as well. There is less and less uncontrolled airspace, and there are some choke points in the uncontrolled airspace as well, which can get a little bit busy. So there are rules about flying in both controlled and uncontrolled airspace. So whilst it's uncontrolled, that simply means it's not controlled by air traffic control. There are lots of rules that we need to apply to make sure we don't put anyone else at risk or put ourselves at risk. The controlled airspace, there's four sort of key areas or zones which we need to remember. So the first one is CTR. CTR is a control zone, and zones always start at the surface and go up. So if you see anything to do with a zone, it's surface upwards. And typically these are around major airports. So Manchester, for example, has a big control zone. And when we look at the air map later, we'll be able to see that pretty clearly. Some airports also have control areas, CTAs. CTAs have the same sort of rules as zones, which we'll come on to, but they just simply don't start at the surface, so they have a different name. Above the CTR, we have a TMA, Terminal Control Area. It used to be called a Terminal Maneuvering Area, hence the acronym. And what these do, these are sort of busy junctions and control areas where airways meet above the major airports. This is where aircraft get put in holding patterns and all that sort of thing. So we'll start there, holding descents, they're, again, busy areas which we're typically not allowed into. They're usually quite high as well, so typically wouldn't want to go in them either. Wouldn't be able to go in them. And then above all those, we have airways. And these are typically corridors, often 10 nautical miles wide, sort of motorways in the sky, shall we say, which tend to converge on the major airports. And if we look at these side on, then this is how they work. So typically they get lower and smaller as they get closer to the ground. So you can imagine aircraft coming in from wherever, far-flung destination, through the airways. They then get brought into the TMA by the air traffic control units, and then from there into the control zone, the CTR, for final descent, landing, or for whatever it is they're doing. Within a CTR, there's also an ATZ, an aerodrome traffic zone, but they are not marked on the maps. The rules within that ATZ will be the same as the rules within the CTR, so all it does is clutter the map up, but there is one in there nonetheless. So on here, for example, again a bit of an old map, but we've got Stockport here. So down here somewhere is Manchester Airport. Here, this, I should have a pointer, shouldn't I? This dotted line here, right, that is the edge of our CTR. So our CTR is a control zone, which, because it's a zone, goes from surface to 3,500 feet. So that's that bottom part of that sort of upside down pyramid that we saw, that cone. Then just outside that, we've got the CTA. That's our control area. That goes from 3,000 feet to 3,500 feet. That's just a little bit wider, same height. Above all that, in this red area here, we've got the TMA, which is 3,500 feet upwards. So here, within this, we've got our CTA, 3,000 to 3,500 feet, plus the TMA, 3,500 feet upwards. So that's our manoeuvring area, where they sort the aircraft out, line them all up. And over here, this is our airway, coming in from the east, over the north of Sheffield. Airway 975, 3,500 feet upwards. So that's what they look like visually on the map from above, plan view, shall we say. And then from a side view, you can see how they tie up. That's what they look like from the side view.
Can you just show me again where the airway is on
that? Yeah, the airway is this, you can't quite see it there, it's this corridor that sort of goes out like that. Okay. So it's this red zoned area, this red with the shading on the inside. Again, we'll come to the, when we start looking at the symbols on an air map, that'll become clearer. That's the airway, essentially.
So Brad, we're just off the bottom there?
Yeah, it's sort of down there somewhere. So it's Lady Bower and Bradwell's down here somewhere. Okay. Another bit of flying airspace that we can't go into, or may not be able to go into, is when there's a royal flight. So a royal flight is a flight carrying one of the principal members of the royal family. And there's two types of flight that they do. Either a helicopter flight, where they don't do anything special, they just get in and fly. But where they're flying fixed wing, typically what they do is they will create temporary airspace. So this temporary airspace will be a Class D type airspace typically. And Class D airspace, if you just sort of glance back to two or three slides before, isn't open to hang glider and paraglider pilots unless they're in contact with air traffic control. Any ideas how we might find out about these royal flights and whether there's some temporary airspace?
No TAMS,
spot on. There you go, that's what they're for. Right, any queries on that little section? As I say, we'll come onto air maps quite a lot a bit later and start to learn some of the symbols if you don't know them. Okay. So what I want to talk about now is VMC and VFR, and IMC and IFR. So VMC are visual meteorological conditions, and VFR are the visual flight rules that you follow when you're in visual meteorological conditions. IMC are instrument meteorological conditions, and instrument flight rules are the rules you follow if you're in IMC. So, going through it logically step by step, we always fly an aircraft according to one of these two sets of rules, either VFR, visual flight rules, or IFR, instrument flight rules. And the rules that we follow depend on the conditions that we're in, the meteorological conditions that we're in, and the airspace that we're in. So those two things combine. And I'll explain how they combine in a little bit. When we're in visual meteorological conditions, we fly under VFR, and the basic rules are see and avoid. If we're not flying in visual meteorological conditions, by default we're flying in instrument meteorological conditions under IFR, and there are specific rules that are applied to ensure the aircraft are separated. So there's different types of visibility that are needed in different types of airspace. And here's where I put up this really busy slide. And no matter what I do to try and break this down and present it more clearly, it's always a ridiculously busy slide. So what I've got, the key bit, I've zoomed in on the next slide, so let's not worry about that for a minute. What I had in my pile before I left the house was a copy of this I could just pass around. Let's not worry too much. So this is a UK ATS airspace classification. If you search for that on Google, you'll come up with either this diagram or a newer one, which is less clear. So that's why I put the old one up. It's exactly the same. It'll look roughly the same with the same sort of tabular layout, the same sort of pictures, but it's worth having a glance at. But let's just run through it. So here, on across the top, we've got our classes of airspace. So A, B, C, D, E, F, and G. And down the left-hand side here, this top row is instrument flight rules. This bottom row is visual flight rules. Class A are things like the airways. So, for example, if I go back to here, terminal maneuvering area, class A, airway L975, class A. So they're the class A types of airspace. Here, control zone, class D, control area, class D. So on our maps, it tells us what class of airspace we're dealing with. Class A airspace, I'll just sort of go through it briefly. So instrument flight rules, air traffic control provides separation for all the aircraft. You need to have a radio clearly, you need to have air traffic control clearance. You cannot fly there under visual flight rules. Okay, absolutely not. As we go through this into class B, C and D, then air traffic control provide everything under instrument flight rules. It gives you a little chart about what visual meteorological conditions are. So for example here, you can't read it, but it says you've got to be clear of cloud, sideways and vertically. You've got to be able to see 5 kilometres below flight level 100. Above that, you've got to be clear of cloud and see 5 kilometres. So it tells you. So if I'm clear of cloud and I can see 5 kilometres, I am in visual meteorological conditions and I can fly under visual flight rules. Okay, but I need a radio, I need ATC clearance for class B. Right. So if I've got a radio, I can ring up ATC and say, can I fly please in your class B airspace? The same for C and the same for D. So for all of these, right, we need radios to fly in their airspace under visual meteorological conditions. If I go to the other end, F and G, which we typically fly. So VMC, visual meteorological conditions. This is where I zoom in. That's clear, isn't it? Okay, so that's the same picture zoomed up. So zoomed in, if I'm below 3,000 feet, right, if I'm clear of cloud and I can see 5 kilometres and I can see the ground, right, I'm in visual meteorological conditions. If I'm above 3,000 feet, again I've got to be 1,000 foot below cloud, 1,500 metres clear of cloud horizontally and see 5 kilometres. If I'm above flight level 100, which on an average day is 10,000 feet, then I'm probably fairly happy, or scared, not quite sure which. But I've got to be able to see 8 kilometres. Okay. This is for class F and G airspace, so this is where we generally fly, so these are the numbers which you might consider remembering. There's a caveat to this, right? If I'm a normal aircraft flying along at 150 knots, I need to see 5 kilometres, see the ground, and be clear of the cloud. However, If I'm flying at less than 140 knots, then I can fly when the visibility is 1500 meters. But I still need to be able to see the ground and be clear of cloud. Okay?
So in accordance with that, then, if you reach cloud base at 4 grand, you're no longer VMC.
Exactly that. Yeah. If you fly at cloud base, we're not in VMC anymore. Okay? And then just for completeness, going back to this chart. So class A to D, we need radios, whatever we do. Class E, I think there might be one in the UK, then we don't need radios to fly in visual flight rules. So that's a sort of a transition one. But generally, we're flying in class F and G. And it's class F and G stuff that you need to remember, because that's the useful stuff for when we fly. Any queries on that?
So F and G is the same one? So.
Yes. Yeah. And I don't know why. I think there's a slight difference between the IFR rules for F and for G. I think that's why there's two different classes. Otherwise, everything is almost exactly the same. Certainly, the visual flight rules are exactly the same for the both.
Where do you take the visibility from? How do I know what's the visibility on the...
You just have to make a judgment. Yeah. If you can see the coast, it's okay. I mean, on the days when we go cross-country, then we can see a long, long way. So, you know, and they're the days where we, you know, we'll be out and about, you know, clear of the sights, and so generally on cross-country days, then we can see 5 kilometres or 50 even. So, night flying. Night flying, regardless of how far you can see, night flying is always instrument flight rules. And night is defined as half an hour after sunset and half an hour before sunrise. Then that is sunset and sunrise at the ground, on the ground, which is important. It's be a lot darker on the ground. If you're happily flying at 3,000 feet and it's half an hour after sunset on the ground, it'll be pitch black, and I wouldn't recommend that. So if you're flying at night, you need to display lights for that particular category of aircraft. That's what you need to know about night flying. Okay, any queries on that little section? Right, talk about air maps now. Reading air maps. And for me, this is this bit and the next bit are some of the most useful ones for actually, you know, being out and making decisions on the day. And when you're actually under a cloud and wondering what to do next, where to go next, these are the bits which make the difference between a good decision and a delayed decision, which usually ends up on the deck. So in terms of air maps, the country is divided up into 3 flight information regions: Scottish FIR, London FIR, and then the upper FIR, which covers flight level 245 to flight level 660, which is 24,500 feet to 66,000 feet. And it's we won't be going there. So we need to just concern ourselves with London and Scottish FIR. In terms of air charts, there are 2 families of air charts that are available that cover the UK. The first is the topographical air chart, and this covers the UK in about 18 sheets. The scale is 1 to 250,000, or about an inch for every 4 miles. It's also known as the quarter million map, because of the 1 to 250,000. This is great for showing detail on the ground. If you're actually going to use a map to try and work out where you are, which is quite old school, but if you're going to do that, then this is a useful map to have. However, its key drawback is that it doesn't show any airspace that has a lower limit below 5,000 feet or flight level 50. Typically, we will be concerning ourselves with airspace that has a limit above that, or at that level, or above. On a good, decent cross-country day, we can be flying at 6,500 feet, so we need to know about that airspace. So that's a limited use if a flight goes above the altitude. It's great for general aviation pilots who tend to take off and fly around at 1,500 feet everywhere. But we tend to go much higher than that. Nonetheless, we need to make sure we know the symbols and markings on this map, which are very similar to the symbols and marking on the smaller scale map, which is the 1 to 500,000 map, or the half million map. So here it's about an inch for every 8 miles. It's the half million map. It's three sheets, which is exceptionally convenient. The dividing line is Derbyshire, which is exceptionally inconvenient. So you need two sheets. You absolutely need them both. So these show all airspace. They're the standard map that most people use. I and a lot of other experienced pilots, despite having all the latest gizmos, still fly with these maps and look at them in the mornings of a cross-country flight or the night before to plan. And they are much better for getting a good forward view of what's happening 50k down track or 100k down track than a small 5-inch moving screen is. So I would recommend flying with these. You should legally fly with them. A lot of people don't, but I'd recommend flying them nonetheless. You need to make sure you know the symbols and airspace markings on this map as well. So for those of you who haven't seen it, this is a half million map. So this is the southern one. Which is the same map on there, I believe. Yeah. I think they've joined them both together on that one. Or is that the smaller scale one? That's the smallest. That's the quarter million maps, where they put about a few quarter million maps together on that one. So this is the half million map. And we'll go through that in a bit when we plan our route to Skegness. So we talked earlier about airspace classifications, and here's where some of the stuff that was talked about earlier starts to present itself more clearly now. So airspace is all marked on the maps. So we've seen a couple of snapshots of maps now, and on the right-hand side, we've got our clusters of airspace and the borders, which you will see on the map. Ignore the bottom two. So, red stuff, and it has like a sort of light red shaded border on its inside, so you can tell which side is the stuff you need to stay out of for the Class A. Class C airspace here is just showing a dotted line, a broken line. Again, the shaded stuff is on the inside, so you can clearly see which bit you can't go in and which bit you can stay this side, that's fine. Class D the same, and Class E is also presented in a similar way. It shows these as Class F and G, but I've never really seen those on a map, so I wouldn't worry about those too much, but you do need to concern yourself with these. These are important. And sometimes they overlap, so you can have the same borders, the same boundaries, but at different heights. For example, Class D control zone and a Class A airway above it, or a TMA sat above it. So particularly around Manchester, there's several common borders around Manchester. And the things which we need to concern ourselves with the words, so here we've got a control area, we've got Class C airspace, so we know at a glance whether we can go in there or not. We've got the bottom height, the bottom limit, so if we're under 2,500 feet, we can go underneath it, that's fine, we're not in it. And the top, so here the top is marked as a flight level because it's above that transition zone. So flight level 185, where and where the pressure on that day is the average pressure, that'll be 18,500 feet. So that's how we read these things. This is airway L10, flight level 45 upwards. Okay? There's lots of circles on air maps. A lot of them you need to concern yourself with, some of them you don't. And one of the key, key things to learn early is which circles you need to worry about and which ones you don't. Because if you start going around circles, you don't need to worry about them, and that's just frustrating. So we've got on here an aerodrome with facilities. So this means it's a You can sort of, you don't have to worry about it. Aerodrome with facilities, aerodrome with no facilities. And then what they start to do is to mark these further. So we've got our little blue circles, and they might have other symbols in them. And we'll come across several of those other symbols. Nonetheless, the blue circle is an aerodrome. So in this case, the aerodrome's got an H in it, so it's a heliport. If it's a government aerodrome, typically military aerodromes, then they are red and marked in red. So here we've got a government aerodrome, which can use for civil use as well, government heliport. So again, all they've done, taken the government aerodrome, put an H in it, and it's a heliport. And then after that, there are several other things which they can put in these circles to denote exactly what they are and what happens. So an M is a microlight flying site, for example. If it's got an X in it, it's disused or abandoned. So it's there just simply for navigational reference. And there's quite a few disused and abandoned airfields around. Some of them haven't, you know, you might have a couple of industrial units on the edge, but they still, you know, runways are still fully there, and they look like operational airfields. So great for navigation, but they can just put you off slightly. Up near Beverly, just north of Hull, Beverly Airfield, which was until very recently an active airfield with an aerodrome with an ACZ around it, it's still an active airfield. Just about 2 miles from that is another airfield, and it's very easy to get confused between the two. So just watch for the markings on the air maps. Every single one of these has, by the side of it, a little number. And that number is its elevation above mean sea level. So it's the elevation at the centre line of the runway above mean sea level. And that's important. And there's more we can do with these airfields. So, for example, if we've got a G there, then it's a glider launch site. And by the side of the G, we've got a little slash 2.5, and that is the elevation at which they might take the winches up in thousands of feet. So they might be winching up to 2,500 feet above the field in that case. And that's why we need to know how high that field is above the ground, above the sea. Because we're flying along, we know our height above sea level. We've got a gliding site ahead of us, which might be winching to 2,500 feet. That gliding site itself might be at 250 feet, so we need to add all those together and know that we have to clear that by 2,750 feet to make sure we don't get in their way. So if there's other stuff going on, then they just simply put extra letters and words alongside it. So it is an airfield, right? But it's also got gliding going on with a cable to 2,500 feet. They've also got gliding going on here, but there's no cables in this case. But you might just want to watch out for tugs, for example, and towing up gliders. So again, this should be in the CP. So this should be stuff you know, but nonetheless may not have come across yet until you start going cross country. And this is our ATZ. So this is from the quarter million map, which is in more detail. So on the quarter million map, it shows you the little cross runways, where they are and where they line up. On the half million map, you don't get that detail. But the key things on here, so we've got Syston, its name, 224, the height of the runway above sea level. We know that there's glider activity there, and they might be winching to 3,300 feet above the airfield. So we know we'd have to add those two together and clear that by 3,540 feet. Have I done the maths right? No, add the two together. So 3,524 feet to clear that. Right. We also have this border here, this boundary. That's the boundary of our ATZ around this. So we've got the airfield inside, which is marked, right? We've also got this ATZ outside. And this ATZ is an area which we typically can't go into. And an ATZ around it would normally be, it would normally have these dimensions. So it would normally be 2 nautical miles radius, normally be 2,000 feet high, and that 2,000 feet is above the runway centre line again. So the ATZ at Syston goes up to 2,224 feet above sea level, and it will be 2 nautical miles radius. Where the runway is particularly long, which is occasionally, then the ATIS will be 2.5 nautical miles radius. But you'll be able to see that on the map. It'll look a little bit bigger. So here, for example, we've got Oxton, an airfield on its own with microlite activity. We can fly right over that, that's fine. We want to watch out for microlite, sure, we can fly right over that. But when it comes to Syston, right, we can't fly within that ATZ, in that dotted circle. We can fly over it, but we can't fly in it. And the other thing just to note is that these diagrams which we see here, from a practical point of view, they look like nice little sort of squat circles, but they are massive, absolutely huge. If you want to glide over one of those, you need to be a significant altitude, and even then you may not even make it. They're a long, long way. So don't take that as what they physically feel like when you're approaching one. And it's usually better to try and go around. Okay, that's ATZs. Then we have MATZs, Military Aerodrome Traffic Zones. What an MATZ is an ATZ. We've got our ATZ, got our airfield, got our ATZ. And then because it's military fast jets, typically, they then put another zone around that. And that zone will extend to 3,000 feet normally, and with a 5 nautical mile radius. So these are quite chunky pieces of airspace. But because that's not enough, then we also have this stub or panhandle here, which is usually in line with the main runway, which is starts 1,000 foot above the runway center line, goes to 3,000 foot at the top of the mats, and typically comes out 5 nautical miles, 4 nautical miles in width. And all those dimensions are on there, for example. That's the typical standard mats. This is its simplified form. It's not uncommon to have two stubs. It's not uncommon to have mats joined up with a couple of stubs sticking out. And a mats, we can fly in a mats legally. Whether you choose to do so or not is a different matter. They're there for a reason. There are fast jets going in and out. Whether we choose to fly on the mats or not, we cannot fly within the ATZ that sits within that mats. Okay. Something else on the maps are the red bits. And the red bits can get quite confusing. So there's three sorts of red bits: prohibited areas, restricted areas, and danger areas. And these are all shown in pretty much the same way. They're shown as either a solid red line or a dotted red line, which is hatched. And within that, there is a number, which is its effective altitude in thousands of feet above the ground. Sorry, above sea level. Not all of them are active all of the time, and if they're activated by a NOTAM, then they're shown with a broken boundary line, a dotted line. So again, another reason to check our NOTAMs. Thought I'd have more on that. Right, so just to clarify what those three things are. So prohibited, as it says, you cannot go there. So that's an absolute no-no. the next one is restricted. A restricted area can be restricted to certain types of aircraft. So typically, most prisons will have a restricted area over the top of them, which is restricted for helicopters. So just because there's an R on there, a little red circle with an R or something, doesn't mean we can't go in there. And if that's right on our route, It's really nice to know in advance that we can go in it without having to worry about it on the day. Again, another reason for doing good planning. And then we've got danger areas. They get more confusing because some of those we can go into. They're only illegal to go into if they've got this little symbol by them, which means that there's a local bylaw which prohibits their entry into them. However, they are danger areas for a reason, and particularly the one at Buxton. I know at least one person who works in the area at Buxton who would suggest it's exceptionally dangerous to be flying over that. It's a vent for explosives, and if you fly over that when that's going off, then you'll be in some serious trouble. So I would avoid danger areas, albeit they're not illegal to enter unless they've got the little asterisk, or on some maps I think there's a different symbol by the side of them. It's also worth noting, just as an aside, that some dangerous places aren't marked on the map as danger areas, and rifle ranges are one. So if you know, there's a rifle range in the vicinity, if you're flying in Surrey and going to fly over Bisley or something like that, then make a note of where that is on the map, because it's not marked and you don't want to be landing in the middle of a rifle range. Other areas. So these diamond symbols, this is a area of intense aerial activity. It marks those areas. And these cover huge swathes of the country. Most of East Anglia, for example, most of Cumbria, a lot of Scotland, and typically is where the fast jets practice in these areas of intense aerial activity. High intensity radio transmission area. These again are areas where it's not illegal to go in them, but they're there marked for a reason. They may well send your instruments funny, they may well send you funny. And if you've got high density microwaves being given out, then you don't really want to go flying through those sort of areas. One in particular on a route from here is Filingdales, and on the route up to Scarborough. One day some of you will do that flight, and you'll want to know that that's there and to go around it. Bird sanctuaries. Really strongly recommend you don't fly in bird sanctuaries. There's nothing you can perfectly legally, but it would be really bad PR. Gas venting operations, again, something to avoid. You can fly through them, but they're marked as red on the map for a reason. Laser sights, again, for the same reason. And here, this note, small arms ranges aren't marked, so they don't attract danger area space status, so just be aware of that. Hang gliding and parachuting sites, hang gliding, paragliding and parachuting sites. There was a time when hang gliding sites were, hill sites were marked on air maps, and they are no longer marked on air maps. And that is something to be aware of, because it may be that other pilots don't know of our potential presence. However, where it's a ground-based operation, then there may well be a marking showing a hang gliding paragliding site. The symbols are the same as for a gliding site. The numbers are the same. So there we've got a hang gliding winch launch site, which might have cables going up to 2,500 feet. Parachuting drop zones. Then these are again marked. They are legal to fly through. However, I would strongly advise not flying through them, especially on the days where we like to fly, because they're the days the parachutists like to fly as well. And they usually contain people moving quite fast, and lots of them, so they're areas to avoid. They are also considered to be a danger such that if you want to put your flight in the XC League, if you go through a parachute drop zone, it will be pulled. You won't be able to do that. It's treated as any other bit of airspace that we're not allowed in. So go around those. Ground obstacles. There's a few ground obstacles that we need to be aware of. and we've got, I'll just go through them in order. So we've got an exceptionally high obstacle, a single obstacle, multiple obstacles, and then we've got this zigzag line, which is cables joining these obstacles. And these have, I don't know why these do and nothing else does, but these have two lots of numbers by the side of them. We've got the height above ground level and the height above sea level. So in italics, we've got the height above sea level, and in brackets, it's the top of the obstacle above ground level. I don't know why nothing else does that, but these always have both numbers. And there's a few of these we need to concern ourselves with. Flying north from here, there's a wind farm, and then we've got Emlymore Mast. You know, Emlymore Mast is marked as a very high obstacle. Wind farms we mark typically as a single as or multiple obstacles, with both things to avoid. And these are some of the things, I'm confusingly going to put these up here, but you don't need to know about them, right? And the reason to put them up is because, just to give you an idea of some of the symbols and markings on the map where you're going, do I need to worry about that or not? So it is actually worth going through and remembering what they are, if only then to know that you can dismiss them. Right, so we've got these big circles, these compass roses. We've got various radio directional beacons, which are used by general aviation traffic to get their position. If they're unsure of their position, they can get their position. So you'll see these marked. I think there's a radio navigation beacon just south of here, and it's just a symbol that you can just dismiss, just unclutter your mind from that bit. For me, that's what's going cross-country flying is about. It's about just making decisions on the flying and not worrying so much about navigation. Okay, any questions on map symbols? Right.
Can I ask you about maps in general?
Yes.
And obviously they go out of date. How often do they get re-released?
I think about every 3 years or so.
Right.
Yeah, I don't know exactly. I think so as and when is needed. But there's usually a bit of PR about it and stuff. So this is certainly a current one. Of course, they're all dated. So this is, edition 41, 2015. So I might expect another one next year or the year after, I would say. But already on here, there's several things out of date. There's several 80Zs which don't exist anymore, for example. And so it's always worth having the most up-to-date one. But if you're flying with moving map software, then that will typically be much more up to date. Anyway.
Coming back to the airfield and the height, what does AAL stand for? There's one there on the maps. It says 2004 AAL.
AAL, I can't remember exactly what it stands for, but it is at the height. Above aerodrome level, is it? Okay, thank you. Yeah, it's the height of the centre line in the middle of the runway. But, yeah. Okay. So, because you've been sat there long enough, I've got a little exercise for you. So, what I've got here is some symbols on flashcards. So, on the one side, we've got little symbols. On the other side, it tells you what it is. So, if you can sort of pair up, I think, or maybe a couple of threes, then we'll just spend 10 minutes going through those. So what I want to do now is talk about rules of the air. This is going over old ground, I hope. But nonetheless, it is in your pilot exam. And you will come across the other aircraft when you're out and about flying cross country. So, collision avoidance rules. Number one, regardless of what any other rule is, it's your responsibility to take all possible measures for the safety of your aircraft and make sure it doesn't collide with any other aircraft. So, regardless of the fact that the other person is in the wrong and remains in the wrong right until the point that he hits you, it's your responsibility to get out of the way as well. A useful tip, if you're on a constant bearing with someone, so if that pilot is there and you look away, you look back, and he's still there, but bigger, you will hit. There is no doubt that you will hit. So at that very point, you know, at that point, however far away they are, you need to start taking avoiding action. And this one's a bit tricky for us, but we shouldn't be flying close enough to other aircraft, so there's a chance of collision. In a scrappy day on the hill when everyone's trying to climb away in the same thermal, then that can become difficult. But there will always be other thermals and other days, and it's really not worth putting lives at risk for that. So, a few key things. Following a feature. Bizarrely, this happens still a lot. In the days of a GPS where everyone would fly from Nottingham to Manchester, I just plug it in and follow my GPS. No, people still got the M1 across the M62 in an aircraft. And they follow these features on the ground. And when you come to the M1, when you're heading out west, you will quite often see light aircraft below you buzzing up and down the side of the M1. If we're in sight of the ground and we're following a feature, then we need to keep the feature on our left. So, not so important for us, but important when we're coming across the feature, because there may well be other aircraft that are following it. So just something to bear in mind, particularly key things like railway lines and motorways. If we're coming head-on, I really hope you know all this in detail. If approaching head-on, danger of a collision, we both brake right. If we are overtaking the aircraft, which is being overtaken, has the right of way. So the overtaking aircraft has to do all of the manoeuvring. There was a rule, a gliding rule, and subsequently a hang gliding, paragliding rule, that if we're overtaking on the ridge, then we overtake between the pilot and the ridge. That rule is no longer the case. So the recommendation now is actually just to turn back, turn away, if you're in that position. And if you can't do that, you have to do, again, all the manoeuvring. If you try and overtake between the ridge and the other pilot, there's a chance you'll end up boxing yourself in and getting in a position where you can't really recover from. And it turned out that the UK was the only country where we were typically doing that, and it created all sorts of problems when we're flying abroad. So if you've got that in the back of your mind, then lose it completely. So there are no rules for overtaking other pilots on a ridge that are any different to normal overtaking rules. Collision avoidance in terms of converging aircraft. There is priority in the same way as for seafaring vessels, ships actually they're called, the less control you have, the more priority you have. So you can see that here. So flying machines, which are mechanical machines, light aircraft things, have to give way to airships, which in turn have to give way to gliders, which in turn have to give way to balloons. So the less control people have over their aircraft, the more priority they have. So airships have to give way to gliders and balloons, and gliders have to give way to balloons. It's rare we're flying in the same sky as a balloon, unless we're at Saint-Hilaire or something like that, because they typically don't like the thermic conditions, whereas we do. Two converging aircraft on about the same altitude. The aircraft which has the other one on its right must give way. The aircraft on the right is in the right. I don't know who drew this diagram originally. I wouldn't do that. I'd be turning left early. But nonetheless, it's up to the aircraft which is on the left to get the hell out of the way. And in terms of ridge etiquette, then if you've got two head-on aircraft with a ridge there, the aircraft which is on, which is this one, for example, they can't really go anywhere. So the other aircraft has to do all of the manoeuvring. Okay, so this is the old advice. Overtake on the ridge side. The new advice is to turn back if possible. If you are overtaking, bear in mind you may get boxed in. Bear in mind the other glider you are overtaking may turn out from the ridge. So really just stay clear, just turn back early. Formation flying. Again, another tricky one. We often fly in formation as paraglider pilots. But nonetheless, we're not supposed to, unless all the commanders have agreed to do so. This isn't really formation flying, but if there's an aircraft which is obliged to give way, it should turn left or right rather than trying to dive under the other aircraft. If you're flying a hang glider, for example, and you're head on, don't just pull bar on and try and dive under that other aircraft. If you're not expecting it, just steer as you would do normally. And if you do have the right of way, then it said here you should maintain your heading and speed. However, do not maintain your heading and speed until you crash. For me, even if you do have right of way and can effect a manoeuvre that won't be unexpected, then fine, do that. But it's like if you're being overtaken in your car, as the vehicle being overtaken, you should maintain your speed, and it's up to the other car to do all of the braking and accelerating if he gets in trouble. And the same here. So the aircraft which has the right of way should maintain its heading and its speed. And that way the other aircraft will know where you're going to be and will be able to avoid you. display flying. If any of you get into display flying, you need to have a CAA display authorization. It's all got to be vetted by the CAA. There's not many paraglider display flying anymore, but there's a few bits and pieces. Anyone wants to get into acro, then you might fall into that category. And then valuable consideration, which means money to you and I, or payments in kind, that sort of thing. So any flying for which there is some sort of payment, either cash or in kind, then that's considered to be commercial flying and comes under commercial aviation rules. So you're under a whole different set of rules there. And the exceptions are things like competition costs, prizes, cost of displays, and if you've got an employer, and if you're dual flying as a qualified instructor. But if you, for example, get your tandem license and start to take up a mate who gives you 50 quid, then you start to fall under commercial flying rules. So coming up as sort of a few like useful bits and pieces at the start, I showed you a picture of a town and said, are we allowed to fly over that? And that's a tricky question to answer, really. There are some very clearly defined rules as to whether we're allowed to fly over it or not. And it's a question in terms of, and we need to know those rules, but in terms of our interpretation of those rules, then we can be slightly more flexible. So the rule is we can't fly over a congested area below a height which will enable us to land clear, or below 1,000 feet above the highest picked object within 600 metres horizontal radius. Now, how the hell you remember all that when you're just approaching Sheffield is somewhat tricky. Visually, it looks like that. It's particularly good cross-country, that one, from a northerly takeoff in the Peak District. So, got to be 1,000 foot higher than the highest fixed object, 600 metres clear of it horizontally, and be able to glide clear. Now, when it comes to somewhere like the outskirts of Sheffield, which are full of cricket pitches, golf courses, football pitches, then to my mind, we can treat a congested area as the housing estate, which is with the golf course beyond it, for example. The housing estate is the congested area, the golf course is an area to which we can glide clear. If I was flying a Cessna, I wouldn't consider the golf course as a safe landing area, so I would have a very different mentality when it came to approaching Sheffield. I'd want that glide clear to be, somewhere, with a significant landing area that I could land in safely if I was to glide clear. And some areas like the very centre of Sheffield, there I don't consider there are even any safe landing options in the very centre of Sheffield, so you want to be significantly higher there. But for me, it's the glide clear thing from a practical point of view that overrides anything else on this when it comes to actually crossing a big city or a town. Nonetheless, you might need to know those numbers. Open air gatherings. So we're not allowed to fly over an organised outdoor assembly of more than 1,000 people. Again, below a height of 1,000 feet or within 1,000 metres, or again, a height from which we can glide clear. And it doesn't take much to be a gathering of 1,000 people. You know, decent sized village fete will do that, or a carnival. And it's important we're not seen to be, you know, showing off at those sort of places and that sort of thing. So nonetheless, that's the rule. And certainly, you know, things like stadium gatherings, football matches, cricket matches, those sort of things, stay well clear of those. And for example, you know, if the area to which you can glide clear turns out to be Trent Bridge or something and there's a match going on, then, you know, you're in some trouble there, because you're basically landing in an assembly of more than 1,000 people. So this is what that looks like visually, 1,000 metres away from it. Bizarrely, this isn't a horizontal thing, this is just a distance thing, and I don't know why it is, but it is. 1,000 feet vertically, and the ability to glide clear. Low flying, 500 foot rule. We're not allowed to fly close to any person, place, thing, vessel, vehicle, structure, closer than 500 feet, unless we're hill soaring, taking off, landing, or life saving. Again, in practical terms, if we're on a cross country and we're below 500 feet, we're preparing for landing anyway. So that's okay. And if actually we end up climbing out, so be it, but we're preparing for landing. You know, if you are seen to be, I don't know, swooping low over some people, horses particularly, on your way to then go off somewhere else, then that would be a particularly bad thing. You'll break this rule, you'll annoy the people or the horses, and you could well end up with a penalty for doing that, because, you know, if it's in here, essentially it's against the law to do that. So this is the 500 foot rule, applies to everybody, even Santa. So no nearer than 500 foot to any person, vessel, vehicle, or structure, unless you're taking off, landing, ridge soaring, or life saving. Winch launching. So we're not allowed to launch by winch above 60 metres above the ground level, which isn't really that high, and not at all within an ATZ unless we've got the permission of the Civil Aviation Authority. So when we see on the air map Syreston Gliding, who can launch up to 2,300 feet above the airfield level, they have permission from the CAA to do so. That's why it's on the map. Normally, the winch will go up to 2,000 feet. We've seen already two cases like where it goes above that. But normally it will be 2,000 feet or something of that order. Don't drop things. Not allowed to drop anything from an aircraft unless it's you, by parachute or something. Ballast, if it's water or fine sand. Tow ropes, and really that's about it. So, don't drop stuff. Particularly phones, that's always annoying. And a few other bits of common sense things. So, no one under the age of 14 can act as a pilot in command of a glider. It used to be 16, it got amended. People, you mustn't fly under the influence of drugs or alcohol, and you mustn't endanger the safety of any aircraft or cause an aircraft to endanger any persons or property. So general things, I hope that, particularly the last two, I hope that people will just take, you know, as read anyway. Compasses and radios. This is a curious thing to have in here in the modern navigation setup, but nonetheless, here it is, and there's stuff that you have to remember. So, if anyone of you remember compasses, we used to have them before the days of GPS. And compasses have two significant problems. They work on magnetism, clearly, and magnetic north doesn't point the same place as true north. So there's some variation, okay, between true north and magnetic north. This variation changes according to where you are on the planet. It changes with time slowly as well. And if you get into it, you can get these wonderful diagrams of the world with isogonals, which join up the points of equal magnetic variation. But typically, as a Boy Scout or whatever it was you were told that the difference was 8 degrees or whatever it was at the time in England, and simply you just added 8 degrees to your maths when you worked out which way you wanted to go. We need to know, curiously, about magnetic variation as pilots. I don't know why, but we do.
It's practically zero now, isn't it?
Is it?
Yeah, they're more or less the same.
Right, it will change. Deviation, and again, I don't know why I have to tell you this, but I do. Deviation is the effect that an airframe has on a compass, regardless of the fact that there is no steel at all now, pretty much, in any of our aircraft. Then if we're flying a Lancaster, there is some deviation. And so what tends to happen was that whoever built the aircraft knew what effect the aircraft would have on the compass, and they would print out a wonderful chart, or probably handwrite it in italics or something, and then whoever was calculating their direction added the magnetic deviation to the compass heading to get the true heading. So, but we don't, I'm obliged to tell you about deviation, but you're obliged to know about variation. Radios. Radios can be a minefield. The legal position is any radio you fly with must be of an approved type. If you fly with a radio, you must have an RT license, radio telephony operator's license, or operate only on specific glider frequencies. Gliders are allocated 5 channels, which you can see on there, 129.9 through to 130.4, and they can also fly on the international distress frequency, 121.5. Not fly, broadcast. That is the legal position with radios. If you're broadcasting from the air, you should only be using approved airband radios on those frequencies, or with an RT license, you can broadcast on them on any frequency.
Why don't we use those?
Because they're heavy, expensive, and because nobody else uses them. People will generally fly with a 2 meter radio. The 2 meter radio will generally be extended, so it operates outside its normal range, and we use a range of frequencies which are known about, and no one worries us. So. Approved RT radios are hundreds and hundreds of pounds, as opposed to 30 quid for a Fuchsing 77 or whatever it is. The advantage with an RT license is you can start talking to the air traffic zones, you can start talking to airspace and fly through those areas if you choose. But there's only a handful of people in the country who have an RT license and a paraglider license, and probably, you know, less than a handful who have ever used it, really. Right, I just want to go through some abbreviations, then we're going to do another exercise. We're going to fly to Skegness. So, in contrast to the normal don't all shout out at once, I want you to all shout out at once. And some of these you'll have come across before. So, I just want to know what these stand for. So, AIAA.
Air intense aerial activity.
Yeah, you know when I said all shout out at once? ATC, ATZ, CTA.
Controlled area.
And then curiously CTR. Control zone, right? I don't know why it's got an R, but it is control zone, okay? So the CTA, control area, that's easy. If you're struggling, it's a zone, right? Just remember that one. CAVOK, this comes up. CAVOK, I haven't asked you or told you about this. CAVOK means ceiling and visibility OK, which is a response that ATC might give you if you ask them what the weather's like. FIR, flight information region, we had that quite early at the start. So there's three flight information regions in the UK. There's the southern one, Scottish one, and the upper one, which we don't really need to know about too much about. FL, flight level, okay. IFR, and we use those when we're in IMC, which is? Okay. MATS, Military Aerotrain Traffic Zone. So ATZ, Aerotrain Traffic Zone, MATS, just with the word military on the front. So that's the bigger zone with the ATZ in the middle of it. NOTAM, TMA, I'm looking this up, so don't worry. Because they changed it. That's one of the best answers I've had. Because it was terminal manoeuvring area, right, and now isn't. I think it's terminal control area, I'm just going to check. Terminal control area. Again, I don't know why. VFR. Which we use when we're flying in BMC, which is... Okay. Okay, cool. Right, so what we're going to do is fly to Skegge. Who's flown XC here already? Why is everyone pointing to one person? And what sort of distances are you guys doing? 50. 50s? Or 50 that was, wasn't it? 50, okay. So... People who haven't flown XC already, your first XC might be a little hop over the back. Your first XC, I know several people whose first XCs have been in several tens of K. Right? So don't turn up unprepared because you've never flown XC before, and don't underestimate how far you could go on modern wings, even with very little experience. If you can climb away in thermal and happen to find the next thermal a couple of times, then you know you might well have gone 30, 40, 50 K. And So don't sort of dismiss this exercise as, well, you know what, ages since I flew to fly to Skegness. You know, if you've flown 50K once or twice, your next one could be 80, next one could be 100, next one could be 6. And that's the way it works. But it's remarkably common for people to do long flights early on. So we're going to fly to the coast. Hopefully there's enough maps between us. What we're going to do is fly from Bradwell to Skegness. And this is something that I would typically do on the night before if it's a route that I don't know very well, or on the morning on the hill, preferably on the night before. And just simply, you know, having worked out roughly what the wind direction is going to be, can I finish just talking a bit before we go off? Work out roughly what the wind directions are going to be, plot perhaps a range of tracks, and then work out what obstacles are likely to be in the way. Both on the air map and also by looking at the NOTAMs as well. So there's two sources of information. But we're just going to look at the air map. We're going to plot a route from Bradwell to Skegge, because we know it's going to be exactly on Skegge. I want you to just plot that route, go in your groups again, work out what the obstacles are, and then we're going to have a sort of group discussion going through all those obstacles and see whether we've spotted them all. Okay, so I'll give you 10 minutes or so. Right, so I had a lot of planning going on. I had some people going, well, you know, the wind's probably that way, let's go that way. When it comes to it, it's just dark grey over there, and there's no point in going that way. So the only way that you are going to fly is that way. So you have to be able to sort of make those decisions on the fly, shall we say. It's fantastic pre-planning it. If that all works out, then great. But it doesn't always work out. So it's still always worth having these things in the back of your head. So let's just go through this flight. So we are taking off from Bradwell. And what is the first thing we need to concern ourselves with?
Well, maximum climb L.
No, none of the above. A big clue, you're sat in it, right? We need to concern ourselves with a gliding club, okay? So we know there's a gliding club here. We share the ridge with it, and there's other aircraft in our vicinity. They are much faster than us. They can't see underneath them, and we need to make sure that we climb clear of the gliding club. If you're not sure on the rules, they're posted on the way into the Bradwell, onto the Bradwell site, and I can't remember what they are, top of my head, but they ask that we stay clear of their overfly zones for landing, and that we climb well clear of the winch. Okay. Second thing we need to concern ourselves with. Not sure now, are we? someone mentioned it already. The height above here. Which is what?
6 knots.
Flight level 65, FL65, okay? FL65 is not predefined. FL65 will change on the day. On a good day, it will be higher. On a high pressure day, it will be higher. On a low pressure day, it will be lower, okay? We need to know what height flight level 65 is at on the day we are flying. It's unlikely that we take off from Bradwell and go to flight level 65 on a thermic cross-country day. It is quite possible that you will reach that sort of height on a wave day here, if you can take off in the wave or want to. So that's the second thing we need to concern ourselves with. Most of your instruments, most modern instruments, will display two heights, and most of the modern instruments, I want to say modern, 10 years old or newer, will display flight level pretty much automatically. So you should have that on your screen already if you're going anywhere near a flight level. Okay, so we've climbed out and we've stayed below flight level 65. Cloud base is quite low. We're at about 3,500 feet at the moment. What's the next thing we need to concern ourselves with? We're going due west. So no, we're not. We're going due east. It's a westerly wind. Next thing we have to worry about? No. Drone field, cracking. Drone field, yeah, we need to worry about drone field. Can we fly over drone field?
If we're high enough,
if we can glide clear, yep. We can have a drone field. Drone field's quite a small town, plenty of green spaces in it, cricket pitches, that sort of stuff. I'd suggest that we'll be able to fly over drone field quite happily. What about Cole Aston? What's Cole Aston doing there? What is it?
It's an aerodrome.
Without many facilities. No toilets at Cole Aston.
Right.
So, what do we need to worry about with Cole Aston?
Are we over 2,000 foot? And
does it have an ATZ around it?
No.
So, what do we need to worry about in Cole Aston? Yeah, just be aware of any other aircraft in the vicinity. I think it might even be a grass strip at Cole Aston. So just be aware of other aircraft in the vicinity. That's all. It's an active aerodrome. But there's no restriction for us. But don't go flying into general aviation aircraft because you'll not come out well. Next thing we need to concern ourselves with, keep going east. Netherthorpe. It all gets a bit scrappy around there, doesn't it? So, let's assume that we're going to go straight towards Netherthorpe. What's the rules for Netherthorpe? Is Netherthorpe an ATZ?
Yes.
Okay, that's the first thing.
2,000 feet.
2,000 feet above what?
The aerodrome height.
Yeah, so we're flying with our altitude above sea level, and we're flying with flight level. So what do, height do we need to, what altitude do we need to worry about? 2254. So that is the height of Netherthorpe 80Z plus the height of the aerodrome above sea level. So 2254 feet. If we can fly over the whole of that at 2254 feet or above, then we're okay. However, what's above Netherthorpe?
Doncaster.
Okay. So Doncaster. What and what sort of class of airspace is that we're concerned with? And what heights is that working at? Okay, so even if we're at 2,254 feet and above, we're still in Class D airspace, so we can't be there either. Okay. So let's, just for the purpose of the exercise, let's go south of Doncaster and let's go south of Netherthorpe. So we're just skimming to the south of Doncaster airspace. What's the next thing we need to concern ourselves with? Before that, diamond dotted line. What's the diamond dotted line? Okay. So we're entering an area of intense aerial activity. So this doesn't mean that suddenly there's a wall of chaffin tornadoes going up and down, but it's just something to be aware of. Lincolnshire is busy from a military point of view. Well, you can tell that because we're about to fly into about six matches all joined up. So nonetheless, it's something that's on the chart, and whilst you've all ignored it now, which is the fine thing to do, that's right, actually in flight you'll go, oh shit, what was that again? Do I need to worry about that? So there it is. And then we've got those two gas venting stations which people have mentioned. Okay, not very easy to see on the half mil map. They're just there and there.
Oh, yeah.
Not very easy on the half mil map, but they will come up on your moving map, on your Kobo, whatever it is you're using. Or they might do, in which case you need to know what they are. And quite often there'll be little circles on your moving map, and it won't say what they are, it won't be clear, and that's when you pick up your paper map and refer to it. Right, so we're tracking west now. We're tracking south of Gampston. So we need to worry about that. What's the next thing we need to worry about, just south of Gampston? Just south of Gampston. So just so it's on the bottom right corner, the bottom right hand corner of Doncaster airspace. Wind farms. Okay, there's a wind farm there, marked as an obstacle, with the well-known abbreviation WFMU next to it. That's a wind farm. That says wind farm, WF farm.
Yeah.
Okay, so best to avoid those. They stay well clear. They're fine upwind of them, but downwind of them, they're not very nice, and certainly don't go through them. And then what's next we need to worry about?
Dalton.
Yeah. And what's there?
Gliders.
And what height are they winching to?
2,200.
Above ground level. And what height's ground?
155 feet.
Yeah. Okay. So 2355 they might be winching to? Plus the ground. Okay. So, can we fly through there? Are we all right down there?
If we're above, yes.
Sorry?
If we're above, yes.
Are we legally allowed to go there anyway?
Yes.
Yeah. Yes. Okay, we can go there anyway, right? If we're over there on a good cross-country day, they'll be flying, they'll be winching, okay? So I suggest you don't go there. Nonetheless, we're legally allowed to, okay? It's worth noting gliding sites because suddenly around those you get masses of thermal markers. So it's worth just joining them up for no other reason than that. But avoid the winches and the tugs. Right, so we're carrying on going due west from there. What we need to worry about then? What's Wigsley? Okay, disused aerodrome, right? And where is Wigsley exactly in relation to other airspace?
In Skelton
Mats. In Skelton Mats, underneath the panhandle, exactly. Okay, so what are we going to do about Skelton? Let's just ignore the fact there's an airway above it for the time being. Okay, hopefully you spotted that. Right, but we've got a bit of a cluster now of Matses and ATZs. So can we go in the Matses?
Yes.
Okay, and can we go in the ATZs inside them?
No.
What about that restricted area at Skelton, which overlaps Skelton Mats? What is a Mats exactly? Okay, it's not that easy to see. But Waddington Mats has got a restricted area which mirrors it exactly. Can we go in there? What does it say by it?
Note 3.
And what does note 3 say? Note 3 says ring them up. Okay? So if we know we're going that way, we can ring them up. And we can say, is that restricted area active today? And they sometimes will tell us. Sometimes they say it can't tell you. Sometimes they'll say we don't know that far in advance. Sometimes they'll say no, they're not active today. Okay? Suddenly that restricted area is lifted and we've got a massive space now to go between the two ATZs. Right? If that restricted area is active, right, we have a tiny gap to squeeze through. What else? So we've got a tiny gap between the restricted area, right, and top of Waddington ATZ, okay? What else do we need to worry about in that gap?
Lincoln.
Okay? Most flights that direction land either just before or just after Lincoln because of that, okay? It just narrows down all your options. So, but we're having a lucky break. I never have, by the way. I never have managed to fly through that gap yet. But today's a good day, and I've flown through the gap. So what do I need to worry about next?
Okay.
A couple of disused aerodromes. The Bardney and one other. Okay. We're sat under... What number is that? L20-something. Okay. What is that airway, L20-something, whatever it is? You can't see it on the quarter million map on the wall because it doesn't show stuff above a certain height. Okay. That Class A airspace, do we need to worry about that? Okay. Yeah, flight 155, don't need to worry about that. Remember, the quarter million maps only show stuff with a bottom level below 5,000 feet. So that's why we fly with these typically. Then we keep going to the... east, what's next to worry about? Okay, Ashley's Field, which is an airfield, an active airfield. Can we go through that, over that?
Yeah.
Okay, heading down the coast, what we've got just south of Skeggy?
Yeah.
Okay, we've got another airfield just south of Skegness.
Yeah.
Do we need to worry about that one? So this we've got Skegness here, look.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This one here?
No, this that one there is Skegness, yeah.
Right, okay.
There's another circle around it.
Yeah.
So where else is on that circle?
So we go this way, do we go south?
No, I just want to know what's going on with this airfield here, Skegness airfield. Can't sure if I see myself. I've caught myself out. Right, Skegness Airfield. Right, so just south of Skegness, there's an aerodrome called Skegness, curiously, right, with another circle around it with a letter T in it. Okay? I don't know what a letter T stands for. So I've caught myself out there. But nonetheless, right, there's no legal limitation on that. We can fly around that. I'm going to look up what that means in a bit. And then just south of that, again, we've got a bird sanctuary, which we definitely want to avoid, okay? Means it's training. All right, cool. Training for what?
They're doing lots of circuits.
All right, cool. There you go. Thanks. And then, but nonetheless, we're not going to go there because we're going to land as near to the station in Skegness as possible to make our retrieve as easy as possible. Make sure we get ice creams and chips. Okay, so we've made it to Skeggy, or part of the way there, because we've planned it. And you know, any particular route, any sort of wind direction, particular day, particularly sort of northwesterlies and stuff, which has got a long potential track, it's worth doing this. And then comparing it to the NOTAMs as well, and seeing what else, what other obstacles are likely to be in your way. And the more time you spend doing that, and the more often you do that, the easier this side of the flying will become, and the more your brain can concentrate on the enjoyable stuff, looking around, taking in the scenery, flying with the birds, all that sort of stuff. Okay, so anyone got any queries on that little exercise? So just from that, a couple of points. Restricted areas, not always restricted. So we talked about Scampton, okay? The other ones, things like R321, which you might come across from a cross-country from Eme, for example. Again, that's a prison. That's restricted for helicopters only, so we can fly over that. And there are others around there. So just spending a bit of time on the map, and just because it's a little circle with an R by it, if it says note something, just look it up, see what it means. Make a note on your air map. Doncaster, I'll mention this briefly. So Doncaster airspace is a big chunk of airspace for 12 flights a day. Nonetheless, it's there, and it gets in the way somewhat. If you didn't know, the club, along with several other clubs, have negotiated corridors in this airspace. And when you pass your pilot exam, you'll be able to attend a briefing to fly through these corridors. So this is Doncaster airspace, and on here, we've already talked about the fact we've got this Netherthorpe here, we've got Retford Gamston here, and this swathe of airspace here, which is 2,000 feet upwards. And up here, we've got 4,000 feet upwards up this corner. In particular directions, and if the conditions are favourable for the airfield, we can ring up ATC, a few individuals can ring up ATC and request opening of corridors. This is the Upson Corridor, so it basically raises that from 4,000 to 4,500 feet, which doesn't sound very much, but makes a big difference. And the Workstop Corridor, when it's more of a westerly, that raises that whole area up from 2,000 odd feet up to 4,500 feet, which makes that suddenly far more transitable than it was when we just discussed it. So we can start thinking about flying over Netherthorpe, although I still wouldn't be that comfortable with that, but certainly tracking to the north of it or tight to the south of it. So these are things to that you will come across in passing if you haven't already. It's a next step, a further step, shall we say. So if you want any more information, it might be old pictures, but the key things are the pilot handbook, which covers all the syllabus you need for the three topics in the pilot exam. If that's not enough for you, then Air Law and Meteorology is one of a series of about seven books, part of the Air Pilot's Manual. It covers two of the topics. Curiously, it covers Air Law and Meteorology. and then there's things like Laws and Rules for Glider Pilots, Rules of the Air Regs, the CAA website. There's a lot of depth that you can go to, not all of which you need to know. You will come across notes by a chap called Graham Taylor, sadly deceased pilot, who wrote some of the original notes to help people pass their pilot's exam. I would suggest that some of those are significantly out of date now, and if there's a conflict between those and what I've told you today, then you should go with what I've told you today. Equally, there's other clubs have little quizzes on their websites and things like that. Just you know, hunt around and you'll find stuff which is all good, useful background knowledge. Okay, that's all I've got for you this evening. Any queries and stuff, then you know, please ask. Otherwise, I'll let you wind your way away.
Thank you very much. Cool. Thank you.